Estrategia y una gira de estudio que dura más o menos una semana en Isa Mining y una conferencia sobre rescate minero que va a ser en septiembre del 2015 también en Berlín. Y uno de lo que queremos lograr es llegar a tener el Premio Internacional de Seguridad en Minería. Esto es un premio que queremos implementar bianual. Y la idea es hacer algo así como el Oscar de la seguridad en minería. Bien, con esto concluyo. Tengo alrededor de 15 minutos de preguntas. Muchísimas gracias.
Bien, seguiremos el procedimiento de la mañana. Por favor, levantan la mano. Se van a acercar con el micrófono para resolver la pregunta. ¿Todo quedó claro? Invitamos a Tami Iger, por favor, a la presentación. Ok. Por favor, le alcanza el micrófono.
Buenas tardes, nuevamente con todos. Muy buena la presentación, de verdad, le felicitamos. Yo quisiera transmitir una pregunta. ¿Cómo participan los representantes de los trabajadores o si participaron para la elaboración de estas siete reglas de oro en su centro de trabajo?
Lo que ha hecho Isa Mining es recoger desde la práctica y desde la experiencia. O sea, aquí lo que se busca en las siete reglas de oro es marcar una línea de trabajo, ya como una guía, como una promoción a partir de estas siete líneas, que entendemos nosotros son una propuesta de guía para promover la seguridad. Ahora, cuando le llevamos a una organización, la organización tiene que tomar una decisión de cómo va a construir el quehacer de cada una de esas líneas, o sea, cómo va a ir construyéndolo. Ahora, si nosotros vemos el cuadrante que integra la seguridad, podemos poner, si nos imaginamos un cuadrante de doble entrada, uno desde la implicancia de los ejecutivos, de la autoridad, de la línea de mando, y por otro lado, la implicancia de los trabajadores. Si nosotros tenemos baja implicancia de los trabajadores y baja implicancia de la línea de mando de los líderes de la organización, lo que vamos a encontrar es una cultura fatalista, ¿ya? Una cultura que lo que podemos decir es que se maneja a través del acto mágico. Responde al porqué de los accidentes con resultado de muerte, como se lo llevó la pelada, le tocaba, tuvo mala suerte. Cualquiera de esas cosas terminan siendo la representación de una organización con una cultura fatalista. Si nos vamos hacia a la primera etapa de desarrollo de la seguridad, vemos una alta implicancia de los trabajadores y una baja implicancia de los ejecutivos. Y ahí, en minería, por ejemplo, en la minería del carbón, tenemos el que despalda el loro. La incorporación de un loro en las mineras subterráneas del carbón, que cuando se afectaban por el gas grisú, se caían y los viejos salían corriendo. Eso es una cultura de oficio, una cultura basada en la experiencia del trabajador en esas condiciones. Por otro lado, si vemos una alta implicancia de los ejecutivos y una baja implicancia de los trabajadores, lo que vamos a tener es una cultura organizacional muy o extremadamente regulada, basada en procedimientos, no necesariamente por el cumplimiento de los procedimientos. De hecho, los procedimientos rara vez se cumplen. Pero lo que pasa es que está altamente regulada. Lo que nosotros pensamos que es lo mejor es la integración de ambos, ¿ya? La incorporación de procedimientos y reglas cuando corresponde y la incorporación de la experiencia de los trabajadores en la definición de aquello. Por lo tanto, ahí es donde se interrelaciona la cultura de oficio y la experiencia se reconoce como parte fundamental del contexto y también el liderazgo de la autoridad, el liderazgo visible y todas las prácticas que vamos incorporar. No sé si contesté tu pregunta. dado que lo que tiene que pasar es la incorporación de las reglas a cada una de las empresas. Hay prácticas que nosotros ponemos a disposición, pero es la organización, dado su cultura, la que la incorpora, si hay sindicatos más fuertes o no, si hay sindicatos, si hay uniones, o etcétera, digamos. Pensando que son líneas que promueven la seguridad en el trabajo en todo el mundo.
¿Ya? Buenas tardes. Buenas tardes. Felicitarlo por su exposición.
Acá se ve. Sí.
Gracias. Felicitarlo por su exposición y quisiera preguntarle sobre el alcance que tiene ISA Mining. Entiendo que tiene un enfoque bastante internacional. ¿Cómo es que considera las diferentes normas internacionales? Ha mencionado la ISO 45.000, que va en reemplazo de la 18.001, pero aparte, tanto digamos en Estados Unidos como en Europa, hay diferentes normas.
Sí.
¿Cómo es que han considerado ustedes ese marco normativo en las herramientas de gestión que ustedes están proponiendo?
A ver, el marco normativo, dado que ISA, la Sociedad Internacional de Seguridad Social, trabaja junto a la OIT, lo que hacen son, lo que nosotros hacemos desde esa responsabilidad es un marco promocional, ¿ya? Que es lo mismo que explicaba anteriormente. Por lo tanto, lo primero que tenemos que hacer es respetar las leyes del país en el cual nosotros estamos trabajando. Por lo tanto, si es en Latinoamérica, veremos qué normativa hay en Perú, qué normativa hay en Ecuador, qué normativa hay en Chile. Luego de eso, en ausencia de norma específica para algo que nosotros necesitamos incorporar, buscamos la que mejor se incorpora a ese sistema, dada la experiencia y el abanico, tal como planteas tú, de la NFPA, de, ¿no es cierto?, del Instituto Europeo de Seguridad del Trabajo, o las normativas que está sacando el señor Yuka Takala en Singapur con la National University of Singapore, o las normas australianas, que también estamos tratando de encontrar las mejores prácticas, las mejores normas, pero que aquellas que también estén o que sean capaces de ir evolucionando el sistema. ¿Ya? Porque si nosotros incorporamos una norma extremadamente exigente en un sistema que está con una madurez muy baja, lo que vamos a hacer es que se niegue. De hecho, una experiencia que tuvimos en Vietnam fue una discusión respecto al uso del asbesto. Y eso fue bastante complejo porque el gobierno de Vietnam está promoviendo el uso del asbesto. Nosotros lo prohibimos. El uso de asbesto. Entonces, esa discusión es bien compleja y tiene que ver también con la explicación religiosa y de contexto que se dan. Por lo tanto, cuando en un país la religión plantea que tú vas a volver a la vida tantas veces como sea necesario, lo más importante no es, y si la expectativa de vida además es corta, el desarrollo de la enfermedad por exposición a asbesto 40 años, 30 años. Por lo tanto, los efectos de eso no se ven por exposición al asbesto. Por lo tanto, se promueve un uso seguro del asbesto. Ahora, nosotros no lo vemos así. Nosotros prohibimos el uso de asbesto. Por lo tanto, en Vietnam es mucho más importante los aspectos de seguridad. Mucho más importante es el no sufrimiento durante el desarrollo de tu vida laboral. Por lo tanto, el ingreso a esa sociedad es a través de los accidentes con resultado de muerte, las amputaciones, las laceraciones, etcétera, en el trabajo. Entonces, lo que tenemos que hacer es conversar respecto en qué contexto estamos, hacer un diagnóstico de la organización y ver qué normas son aplicables y cómo vamos evolucionando el sistema.
Ahora sí. Muchas gracias. ¿Qué tal? Felicitaciones por la exposición. Vengo de una empresa de seguridad, de JIB Resguardo, Liderman aquí en Perú, y estaba interesada en preguntar cuán importante es aplicar esas 7 reglas de oro y sobre todo cuánto se potencia el llevar a cabo, el ejecutar esas reglas de oro de parte, para mi punto de vista, y quisiera que también me lo confirme o me dé su punto de vista al respecto, de la importancia efectivamente del hombre de seguridad, que es quien va a hacer que se lleven a cabo esas 7 reglas, porque el departamento que elabora, que revisa las 7 reglas, puede estar de acuerdo, puede funcionar en el papel, pero ¿son ellos quiénes son los principales que van a hacer que funcionen en la aplicación?
Buena pregunta. Yo creo que una pregunta que uno siempre se hace, digamos, finalmente, ¿quién hace que el sistema tenga vida? Y es un poco lo que conversábamos hace un rato atrás, digamos. La responsabilidad no queda en quien implementa, en el segurito o el experto o el profesional que se dedica en materia de seguridad en el trabajo, sino que es responsabilidad de todos. Partiendo por la línea de mando top-down, digamos. Ahora, todo el sistema y el contexto de trabajo tiene que tener cierta responsabilidad sobre la acción o no dentro de las reglas. Ahora, las reglas, como son promocionales, tú puedes incorporar más o menos en el sistema, digamos. Puedes tener un sistema tremendamente robusto o puedes tener un sistema que es para pequeñas empresas. Son líneas por las cuales nos vamos a mirar. Lo que nosotros creemos que no tiene que haber es la ausencia de trabajo en alguna de esas líneas. Por ejemplo, no puede haber un sistema que no tenga incorporado la variable tecnología, o la variable persona, o el liderazgo, por ejemplo. Hay que determinar cómo vamos a ejecutar cada una de esas líneas, y para eso hay diferentes herramientas, diferentes implicancias. El tema es cómo lo integramos. Ahora, en mi experiencia, tiene que ver más con el rol de los supervisores, en la conexión entre la autoridad, el liderazgo y la transferencia de ello hacia la cultura de oficio, hacia el hacer. ¿Ya? Y aquí lo que me parece primero es la aceptación del error como parte con natural del ser humano. Por lo tanto, ¿de qué manera también aceptamos el error y tenemos un procedimiento que para mí es el más importante, el procedimiento de sanción justa? ¿Ya? En la medida que tenemos un procedimiento de sanción justa, el sistema, todos los trabajadores y todos entendemos que cuando transgredimos o no una norma, que a qué cosa nos estamos exponiendo. ¿Ya? Eso más o menos. ¿Última pregunta? ¿Alguien? El caballero.
Julio. No sé si me... Julio, mi inquietud es hacerle una, más que todo, digamos, cómo nosotros podemos encajar estas herramientas, ¿no?, que nos estás explicando. Efectivamente, en algunas empresas mineras que he podido visitar, ya tienen implementado algunas herramientas que nos ayudan a ver en la parte de actitud y comportamiento. Básicamente, en estos sistemas de gestión está orientado a la parte de liderazgo, ¿no? Si nosotros no tenemos un buen liderazgo en la empresa minera, entonces vamos a tener cierta dificultad en la implementación de estas herramientas, que mucho nos va a ayudar en mejorar la gestión de la seguridad en la empresa. Básicamente, es importante considerar en la empresa cómo está su cultura de seguridad, ¿no? Dependiendo del nivel de cultura de seguridad que tenga la empresa, nosotros podemos ir implementando mediante un diagnóstico, básicamente, para ver en qué medida podemos nosotros ir beneficiando a la empresa, ¿no?, a la medida, digamos, de las posibilidades que se puede encontrar en la misma.
A ver, si vamos en orden, el diagnóstico es tremendamente importante y es la primera etapa. El diagnóstico no resuelve el problema, sino que el diagnóstico lo evidencia. Nos muestra cómo estamos respecto de donde pensábamos que estábamos. Y en general los diagnósticos de cultura de seguridad se hacen a la organización, pero lo importante es hacerlo a los diferentes segmentos de la organización. Dado que la percepción de seguridad o de cultura de seguridad que hay en los directivos no necesariamente están en los trabajadores, o en los sindicatos, o en la línea de supervisión, o en operaciones respecto de la administración. Por lo tanto, la mezcla de culturas es lo que finalmente determina la cultura organizacional. Ahora, al igual que todo, digamos, las organizaciones no están partiendo, ya partieron. Por lo tanto, lo que tenemos que ver no es cómo hacemos encajar estas 7 reglas de oro en el sistema, sino que cómo el sistema que tenemos es capaz de dar cuenta a las reglas que estamos promocionando. Una de las cosas que, por ejemplo, lo que hicimos el año pasado fue llevar las 7 reglas de oro a una división de Codelco, a Teniente. Y lo que hicimos fue ver, por ejemplo, qué acciones de liderazgo que se estaban realizando. Entonces, lo que hicimos fue preguntarles al equipo de operaciones, de la gente de la vicepresidencia de proyecto, que estaba trabajando en Teniente también, qué acciones de liderazgo estaban haciendo y cómo lo estaban haciendo. O sea, qué están haciendo y cómo, ir a ver cómo se está ejecutando. Y uno va viendo si esas acciones de liderazgo, qué tipo de respuesta están dando. Por ejemplo, en general, todos los proyectos de observaciones de conducta y la estadística que en general mostramos es que 2/3 o 3/4 incluso de los accidentes se deben a comportamiento. Lo que no decimos...
Here to speak to you. I'm very pleased and happy to see that there's so many folks still left after that fabulous lunch that we had. So I'm going to be talking today about human factors design principles for load, haul, dump vehicles. And I thought I'd tell you a little bit about where I'm from and why this is a topic that's really important to me and something that I'm passionate about. I think the other thing that's important is that although we may be talking about a mining-specific vehicle today, many of the messages with regards to human factors can be applied to other types of mobile equipment and other industries as well. So I'm from the city of Greater Sudbury, and for those of you that are familiar with mining, you're probably quite familiar with the Sudbury area. It's north of our neighbors in the U.S. and near the Great Lakes in Canada. But what makes it particularly valuable from a mining perspective, the second largest impact crater hit the area, leaving a very rich deposit of nickel, copper, platinum, and palladium. And for this reason, it's an area that's been mined for many, many years now in Canada, and it's a very rich resource. In fact, it's such an important area that the city of Sudbury decided to erect a monument that was important to them. I think I'm asked to slow down. Okay, I'll slow down, my apologies. So this monument is called the Big Nickel, and it's something that was erected to honor the fact that the region is prosperous because of all the nickel that's mined. Some of the things we've done in terms of line of sight improvement, some of the things we can do around posture and looking at a reduction of vibration exposure as well. Okay, and then we'll conclude with some questions. So we'll start with line of sight. So the question I have here is, what doesn't an LHD operator see? And I think that's really important because their line of sight is so impaired that we should be more concerned about what they're missing in the environment and the fact that that could lead to a fatality. And in fact, in many cases, as it's been talked about, we're just lucky that there aren't more fatalities occurring. Now, let's see if... No. So you're not going to be able to see the mouse, so I'll describe what we're showing here. In the top picture, circled in yellow, there's a little bit of a light reflection, hopefully you can see on your image. That's a pedestrian, and what you're seeing is a little bit of reflection from their retroreflective striping that's on their clothing. Now, as this LHD vehicle moves forward just a little bit, you can see that pedestrian is now completely blocked by that light bracket. So you can imagine if that operator didn't happen to notice that little flash of light, we're very close to having a fatality, okay? And in fact, as I said recently in Ontario, in 2009 and 2010, there were two more fatal incidents involving these vehicles. So one of the first things we did with the industry is we wanted to get a better feeling for what was the operator looking at and what were they able to see. And to help the average individual that wasn't driving these vehicles appreciate just how challenging it is. So we used a type of technology called eye tracking. And really it's a special type of safety glasses they'd put on, and they have two cameras. One camera would show the field of view, so in my case right now, it would show me looking at these engaged audience members. And the other would show back at my eye, so it would show what I'm focusing on. So for example, if I engage with the fellow in the pink shirt, the camera would show me looking at you. So that's how this technology would work. Okay, so we put it in an underground mine. And I may need help to get the video to work here, we'll see. Oh, okay, so what you're seeing is what the LHD operator looks at and sees in this underground mine. Not a lot, right? And primarily where you see that red hash mark, that's where the individual is focusing their attention, which is to the left front corner of that vehicle. And the reason being, the individual really can't see anything else. The only area where they have a little bit of line of sight is to that left front corner, so they focus there. Therefore, if there's something else in front of the vehicle, to the right of the vehicle, if they go to turn a corner, you can imagine if there is a worker in that area, the likelihood of a collision between that vehicle and the pedestrian is quite high. So we were engaged by the mining industry to do some what we called line of sight evaluations to try to then provide more data about the extent of this. And the simplest method we used is shown in the top corner there, and that uses a light filament. Any of you can do this. In fact, I encourage you, when you go back to your workplaces, if you haven't done this exercise before, go ahead and do it. So you can either put an operator in that position and have them hold a light, or just install a light at the average eye position of the operator, and have other workers walk around that vehicle. If you can't see the light, the operator's not gonna see you, right? You can do this as a simple safety exercise, even taking turns with workers sitting in the cab of the vehicle, and see how far out you have to go in front of that vehicle in order for the operator to see you and for you to see the operator. Okay, the other method we use involves a laser scanner where you can do a 360-degree profile and we can create line-of-sight plots. So for example, what this looks like then, all those gray areas are complete line of sight blockages. The red zone is the distance you have to be in front of that vehicle to see to ground. So on your right, you need to be about 30 meters to the front right corner to see to ground, and about 45 meters to the back right corner to see to ground. So tremendous blockage area. If we look at what this would look like using the 3D laser scanner, all of those black zones are complete line of sight blockages. Okay, and this profile is 15 meters to the front of the vehicle and 15 meters to the back, 10 meters wide. But we realize that it's a little bit more challenging to understand the information in this capacity, and so we went to computer simulation to show the same thing. So we put in a representative miner sitting in the cab. We have the CAD of the vehicle. Let's see if I can pause it. So everything in red is a complete line of sight blockage. Everything in green shows you what the operator can see. So if I stop it there, that red area is due to the cab post. And you can see the profile to the front where the light brackets in the bucket interact to create blockages. So what we've done with this type of approach then is we can look at design changes to see if we can increase the amount of green in the image and therefore increase the line of sight. So some of the things that we've shown are problematic. We know the design of the vehicle when we think about things like posts and windows for the cab, where the light brackets are positioned and the size of those, and the bucket size and engine profile make a difference. So for example, this is common sense, right? If we could design the cab such that the windows are larger and positioned in a way to allow improved line of sight, it's going to benefit the worker. So we wanted to show that again in computer simulation. So what you're seeing on the right side is the original vehicle design. And look at all of the red, actually, sorry, on your closest side here. So you can see the red to that front corner. Now, if we make a modification to that cab where we take and just shift that post a little bit and open up the window, we can create a lot more green now to that from these vehicles. And, you know, it allows you to haul more material. But if you have an oversized bucket and a bucket with teeth added to that as well, we've shown that, again, you just create more of a line of sight impairment to the front of the vehicle. So ideally, you'll keep the bucket size within the operating capacity of the vehicle. The other thing that can be done is modifications to the back of the vehicle. And you can see some of these changes have happened in agricultural vehicles, in school buses, probably here as well. If you can angle that profile down or keep it flat and then round the back corners, you can improve your line of sight. And in fact, we were able to show with the design in blue that you could get up to a 7.3% increase in line of sight. So we've been working with a number of the equipment manufacturers, and some of these changes have started to happen. Our concern, though, moving forward is that with some of the new engine requirements, so in particular the new Tier 4 engine, that's going to be a larger, bulkier engine, and the ability to make some of these design improvements will be impaired. So we can't rely on design alone. You know, there's other things that we have to look at in order to allow the operator to have improved line of sight or situational awareness. And one thing that happened coming out of that fatality that happened in 2009 was recommendations from the coroner's inquest. And I'll go through some of these here. So one recommendation was to look at the sitting height of the operators in these vehicles and the potential to use rotating or swivel seats. And again, the reason that's important is, remember we talked about the musculoskeletal injuries that these workers are having. So if they're sitting in these rotated postures. And we wanted to get an idea of, well, how bad was it? Okay. So we did is we put a number of small digital cameras in the cab, and we recorded the operators for a full 8-hour day. And here's a picture of some of those postures. And what we found was that the workers had their neck rotated more than 45 degrees for over 89% of the shift. Almost 90% of the shift with the neck rotated 45 degrees. So let's ask folks here, what that would mean is, I'm just gonna get you all to shift sideways in your seat, and then you can rotate your head 45 degrees and you can watch the rest of the lecture in that position. Some of you are great, you're actually doing it, fantastic. It's not gonna be comfortable, right? And not only do we do that, we then expose those workers to vibration at the same time. So it's not surprising that when they're retiring or they may have to leave work because they have extremely debilitating pain in their neck and their back. So what does this look like? Again, we recorded the individuals. So here's the video that you saw before, and here's the posture video with that. So the individual's being shaken up, and they're in this rotated position. Trying to, again, pay attention to what's happening in their environment. So not only are they uncomfortable, but we're asking them to pay attention and do very important work. So seat rotation, back to one of the recommendations. We did some research and we were able to show that, yes, in fact, if you are able to provide rotation of anywhere from 20 to 45 degrees, you can get a reduction in the amount of neck and trunk rotation required for you to navigate that vehicle. And in fact, we did have one manufacturer that installed a rotating seat on a vehicle that was used in an Ontario mine. And unfortunately, it didn't stay in production for very long. And the reason being, although the operators were more comfortable, they weren't able to rotate their seat fast enough to have the productivity at the level that they were able to maintain the same level of bonus. Which brings us into a whole nother argument. But I think it goes back to this concept again. At some point, we need to decide what's more important, high levels of productivity or having technology that will allow workers to be safer and be more comfortable. So something for us all to keep thinking about. The other thing that we see that's happening in Ontario is that larger and larger vehicles are being put into the mining drifts, so there's very little clearance left for the top of the vehicle and the sides. So the large vehicles can move more material, but it ends up, again, creating more of a restriction for the operator. We do know that if we can increase the sitting height of the operator, we can improve what they can see as well. The other thing that's happening in some of these cases is the operators adjusting their seat in order to get that increased height, but by doing so, they take away from the vibration attenuation abilities of that seat, and I'll come back to that later as well. The other thing that was recommended by the coroner's inquest was to look at the use of cameras on these types of equipment. So our research team also did some of this work initially in virtual reality. And what you're seeing here is, if we look at the LHD vehicle making a right-hand turn, when that vehicle articulates, what the operator ends up seeing is shown in that top view, the big yellow cab post. So corners are particularly problematic for line of sight. However, if there's a camera installed on that vehicle to allow forward visibility to that right side, you can now see in the camera view, they can pick up the pedestrian and the potential ground hazard that's there. Okay, and we know cameras can be successful. In fact, I'm sure it's the same here in Peru. In North America, it's quite common that almost every family van that hauls kids around now have backup cameras so that the parents can make sure that they don't back over their kids' bicycles and other toys that are left in the driveway. So the technology is there. So the next step we did is we showed, well, what can happen if you have more than one camera on a vehicle? So the top image with all of the red was the original line of sight profile for that LHD. And with the addition of each camera, you can see we can get more green. So again, we can show that that camera can add line of sight. So we then worked with a camera manufacturer and we did some field testing. And this system allowed the installation of four cameras, two for forward line of sight and two for backward or rear line of sight. Now this first profile then is the line of sight without a camera system, and you can see all of the black. So the black represents a complete line of sight blockage, and the red is the plot to ground. Now, if we let that operator have extreme trunk movement, so, you know, moving and looking, you know, so extreme movement, we can then decrease that back line of sight a little bit. This is what we get with the cameras. So we now only have one very, very tiny blockage, and that red zone has decreased dramatically. Okay? Another way of looking at that, this is the plot if we allow some awkward trunk movements. This is the plot if we have a camera, our first camera facing to the back. And the improvements we get with the addition of the next camera. Now the addition of one of the forward cameras. And the addition of the final forward camera. So it's not perfect, but I think we would agree it's a lot better than without any. And in fact, we've deployed these now at a couple mine sites on a trial basis. And in one mine site in particular, had a couple grad students that were there helping to test the system. And the workers didn't want to actually drive a vehicle without the camera system employed. And so that company is actually looking at retrofitting the rest of their fleet. Now, it's not the only answer, and there are certainly some policies and procedures within the workplace that need to be developed to go with the camera system. But it's, again, using some technology that may be beneficial. The other thing that was asked of us is the coroner's, again, talking about proximity detection. Now, I'm not going to have time to go through all of the scenarios, but what I want to highlight with the potential for both cameras and proximity detection is that we have to think about the increased mental workload for the worker. So we may have the technology that will allow us to inform the worker if there are vehicles or pedestrians close to the vehicle that they're driving. We have cameras that will give that operator a visual field, but we need to make sure that the information is presented in a way that the operator can take that information and make sound decisions, that the information isn't so great that it overloads the operator and increases mental fatigue. And so we're doing some tests right now with both proximity detection manufacturers and camera, the camera company we worked with, to look at how the operators can use these systems to enhance line of sight and situational awareness. Okay, so for purposes of time, I'll just talk quickly about a couple more with regards to line of sight. Retroreflective clothing. So again, this picture here, really that operator should be more visible than what we see with a little bit of that clothing striping. And in fact, there's new standards in Canada that exist for how you use and care for that clothing. So for example, it's not enough to just have the reflective striping, but you need to make sure that it's maintained and that if it starts to wear out, that is replaced so that the same reflective capabilities are applied. Another great source of information around pedestrian and equipment safety is available from the Workplace Safety North website, and I've put the link up there. They're a safety association that works with the Ontario mining industry, and a lot of the research that we do feeds into that association to produce technical documents for the industry. And so they talk about a lot more best practices than I can cover here today around equipment. So I encourage you to take a look at that. Okay, so switching gears, I want to talk a little bit about vibration and why it's important. So we know when workers are exposed to vibration, low back pain, neck problems in particular, are problematic. And what also concerns us is that most of the injuries are where the injury can become more severe is if that exposure is at what's called resonance. And for underground mobile equipment, the dominant vibration frequency typically is around 3 to 5 hertz. And the resonance for the spine is also around 3 to 5 hertz. So we're exposing workers at a frequency that is associated with increased injury risk. So when we do vibration testing, we'll follow the international standards. We'll have an accelerometer that's in a rubber disc that gets attached to the seat, and we'll record using a data logger for an 8-hour shift. There are a couple different standards that exist. The one I'm going to be talking about today is ISO 2631-1, and I'll talk about the EU directives a little bit as well. So I'll just go to this. So when you're determining health risks for ISO, it's based on what's called a health guidance caution zone. And they give you criterion values for 8 hours that will give you an indication of what the injury probability is for that individual. So for example, if the worker is exposed to vibration below 0.45 meters per second squared, their probability of injury is quite low. But if they're exposed above 0.9, the risk of health effects are high, so they're likely. Okay? There's values that are slightly different for the EU directive, but for the purpose of this presentation, I'll just focus on some of our field measurements for ISO for now. So this is what it looks like for the LHD vehicle. Now the red is above the health guidance caution zone, and green is below, and the yellow is within. And we've got small vehicles, which are a six yard haulage capacity, and anything above that is considered a large vehicle. Now, what hopefully you notice from this, all of those vehicles are either within the caution zone or above.